Have you seen those headlines about melatonin being mislabeled or unsafe? A research letter published in JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association, in 2023 found that one melatonin gummy, which is often used by kids, actually contained 347% more melatonin than the label said. That sounds alarming, right? But in this video, I'll explain why it's not as scary as it sounds, what you really need to know about melatonin safety, and why precision still matters. As a sleep doctor, I like to know that what my patients are taking matches what the label says. So in this video, we'll cover what melatonin is actually used for, what the research tells us about short, moderate, and long-term safety, how to think about brand variability and dosing, and what I've seen in my own clinical practice. I'm Dr. Nishi Bhopal. I'm a sleep physician and psychiatrist, and this channel is for you, the healthcare practitioner, to learn practical clinical sleep medicine to use every day in your clinical practice. If that sounds useful to you, then go ahead and subscribe. Melatonin is the fourth most popular natural product taken by adults in the US and the second most popular natural product taken by children in the US. If you're in the US or Canada, you may be surprised to learn that melatonin is not available over the counter in many other countries. In some countries, it is considered a prescription and it does require review by a doctor every few months to continue taking it. I'm based in the US and a lot of my patients are taking melatonin over the counter. They're self-medicating with it, but they don't necessarily know how to use it. Because when it comes to melatonin, the dose, the timing, and the formulation are really important. We'll be exploring more of that in this series on melatonin. Okay, so what is melatonin and who is it safe for? Melatonin is not a sedative. This is what I tell my patients all the time. It is a chronobiotic. It's a hormone that tells your brain that it's nighttime to regulate your sleep-wake cycles. Natural endogenous levels of melatonin rise a few hours before bed. They peak in the middle of the night and they decrease again towards the morning. Clinically, if you're using melatonin supplements, they're actually not indicated for chronic insomnia. The American Academy of Sleep Medicine does recommend it for a variety of different types of conditions, including circadian rhythm disorders like delayed sleep phase disorder, irregular sleep-wake disorder, REM behavior disorder, and in pediatrics, it's used in children with autism, ADHD, irregular sleep-wake disorders, and other neurological conditions. One of my patients, I'll call her Maya, has a classic delayed sleep phase pattern. She couldn't fall asleep before 2 a.m. and struggled every morning to get up and get going. When I suggested melatonin, she was skeptical. She said, "Well, I heard about these headlines, I heard it's not safe, and I don't want to rely on something to make me sleep." So I explained to her that melatonin isn't something you rely on long term. It's a teaching signal for your body clock. So we selected a third-party tested brand. We started with a low dose of 0.3 milligrams. We used it strategically for about 6 weeks alongside light exposure and shifting her wake time. And by the end of that period, her circadian rhythm had advanced, so she was falling asleep earlier and able to get up earlier, and she no longer needed the melatonin. So that's the key. When melatonin is used properly, it is a temporary cue for the body clock. We're not using it as a chronic sedative. Melatonin is a fascinating hormone because it also has anti-inflammatory effects, antioxidant effects. Research is exploring its roles in metabolism, inflammation, neuroprotection, even in ICU delirium, stroke recovery, and a variety of other conditions. I think that's fascinating, and I'm excited to see where the research goes next. But understanding what melatonin is used for is the first step. Okay, so what about the risks, the variability in the labeling and precision of what's actually in the supplement? Going back to that 347% number, showing that that melatonin gummy actually had more melatonin in the gummy itself compared to what it said on the label. Is that dangerous? Should we be alarmed? Well, let's dig into the research a little bit more. It doesn't necessarily mean that the supplement is dangerous, but it does mean that the label can't always be trusted. The research letter in 2023 in JAMA and another study in 2017 in the Journal of Clinical Sleep Medicine found that melatonin content in over-the-counter melatonin supplements ranged from -83% to 478% of what was printed on the label. And some products even contained serotonin or CBD. So that is definitely concerning. If we look at the data a little bit more closely, particularly that study in 2017 in JCSM, the supplement that contained 478% more melatonin than what it said on the label claimed to have 1.5 milligrams of melatonin on the label, and it actually contained 8.67 milligrams. Okay, so we're not talking a difference of 100 milligrams. It still had less than 10 milligrams in it. That's not necessarily a dangerous dose, especially when you look at doses that are used for non-sleep indications. In sleep, we usually use doses of about 0.3 to 3 milligrams of melatonin. But for those other conditions I mentioned, like cancer, like inflammation, we're using much higher doses. In fact, in the neonatal ICU, in the NICU, doses of about 10 to 20 milligrams are used in those tiny little babies for sepsis. The research on melatonin in cancer is looking at doses of 20 and sometimes up to 50 milligrams. So these are higher doses. However, that doesn't mean that we should be willy-nilly in taking melatonin at high doses. For clinicians and for consumers, this matters because if you think you're taking 1 milligram, but you're really getting 9 milligrams, your results will be unpredictable. As a physician, if I'm recommending something to a patient, I want to make sure that the dosing is precise and it's what I am recommending. This is why I always look for third-party tested brands that have the USP, NSF, or Consumer Lab certification. There's other certifications as well to give you confidence that what is actually in the supplement is what it says on the label. In terms of melatonin brands specifically, a couple of brands that I like are Herbitonin for immediate release melatonin, and Clear Labs for sustained release. I don't endorse any specific brand, but I have had good experiences with those ones. If you want more information on specific third-party tested melatonin brands, go ahead and get my free melatonin brand guide for a more comprehensive list that you can use in your clinical practice. The link is on the screen here, and you can also download it below. Now we have a better idea about quality. What about the duration of use and long-term safety? Because this is where a lot of confusion comes in. So let's get some of the terms right. When studies describe short-term use, that usually means up to about 3 months of daily use of melatonin. Moderate-term use is about 6 months. And then beyond that, we consider that long-term use. And that's where the data becomes limited. Most clinical trials have lasted 4 weeks or less. Some have gone up to 3 months, and only a few for 6 months or longer. In those studies, side effects were generally mild, maybe some daytime sleepiness, headache, dizziness, and vivid dreams. Systematic reviews have shown that even with longer use, up to about 7 months, adverse effects are usually comparable to placebo. Melatonin is thought to be safe for longer-term use, although there are reports of nightmares and even effects on mood. And those are side effects that I have seen in my clinical practice as well. There's no evidence of dependence or withdrawal, but we just don't have any robust data on very long-term endocrine or metabolic effects. One of the questions I get a lot is about pediatric use of melatonin, and does it suppress puberty or growth hormone secretion? The current clinical evidence does not support that melatonin suppresses puberty or growth hormone in children at doses used for sleep disorders. If melatonin is going to be used in children, you want to make sure that you're using it for the right indication, that you're using a good quality brand, that the dosing is appropriate, and that other aspects that influence sleep are also being addressed. I do have other videos on this channel with Dr. Funke Afolabi-Brown. She is a pediatric sleep specialist, and she talks more about pediatric sleep, so be sure to check that out if you are working with children. Some studies suggest small changes in glucose tolerance or blood pressure at higher doses, so we do use caution. Remember, melatonin is a hormone. It has downstream effects, so a good rule of thumb is to reassess every few months. My clinical experience with melatonin is that most of my patients tolerate it well, but I have seen a few who developed low mood or depression after taking it continuously for years. It's not common, yet it's something that I always keep an eye on and discuss during follow-up. That's why when I'm using it, I individualize use. We review the indication every few months, and I encourage taking breaks from it, especially if it becomes a nightly habit or if it becomes a psychological dependence, where now the person is afraid they won't be able to sleep without it. That's when we need to address some of the thought patterns that can feed into ongoing sleep issues. Even with a reliable, good quality product, the timing may actually matter more than how much is taken. That's because melatonin is a chronobiotic. It affects the body clock, so timing is key. Check out my video on the phase response curve to learn more about that. So, is melatonin safe? The answer is yes, it is for most people. Short-term use of up to 3 months is generally thought to be safe. Melatonin is a support. This is what I say about any type of sleep aid, whether it's an over-the-counter supplement or a prescription. They're not to be used in isolation without looking at the whole picture and introducing sleep-supporting behaviors and practices. Up to 6 months of melatonin use appears to be fine for most adults, but beyond that, we enter the data unknown territory. Individualized monitoring is key. Melatonin remains one of the most fascinating supplements that I work with. It's pretty versatile, and there's lots of untapped potential as the research evolves.